afternoon, probably in the spring. There's unexpectedly what God requires, and undeservedly decided to come inside. Stuart's generosity of spirit was bounded. Somerset had crossed the boundary from which it was no return. Boundaries of all kinds, imperial frontiers, colonial borders, property limits, were inseparable from the development of colonial America. In 1732, the heirs of William Penn at the Court of Chancery in London to shift the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania to a boundary exactly 15 miles south of Philadelphia, and together with the Earl of Baltimore's family, which owned the Maryland, shared the enormous cost of having a definite boundary run by two British astronomers. After more than 2 years and 230 miles, the authority by the line, high in the Appalachians, reached an older boundary, a war path. This boundary marked the limit of the influence of the Six Nations, who had guaranteed their safety, and the beginning of the Delaware and Shawnee territory. Reaching an indigenous boundary, they would not cross. The Six Nation guards refused to proceed one step further westward. And so, on a bluff, overlooking the Monongahela River, a mound 5 feet high marks what was destined to become a future nation's Somerset boundary, a silent witness to its struggle for centuries to come, with the memorial message Sam Chauncey had etched on Kingman's grave. How on the planet Earth the ocean of law humans inherit ought to instruct and inform the constitutional law humans preserves. So Charles Mason and Jeremiah Dixon scarred the rise of the Mason Dixon. At the 1787 Constitutional Convention, James Madison did not see the line of discrimination as a boundary between the large and the small. It did not lie between the large and the small. It lay between the northern and the southern. The institution of slavery and its consequences formed the line of discrimination. In retrospect, it lay between the nation's ideas of a freedom nation and its practices as a slave nation. The Mason-Dixon line of discrimination juxtaposed the Constitution's preamble with its James Somerset Article 4, Section 2, Paragraph 3. No person held to service or labor in one state under the laws thereof escaping into another shall, in consequence of any law or regulation therein, be discharged from said service or labor, but shall be delivered up on claim of the party to whom such service or labor is due. An article that elevated the individual right of a constitutional person to his constitutional property over a state's right to summon the collective wisdom of common law in defense of freedom. Reading that article, one does not see a Somerset. Yet for three-quarters of a century, Somerset's insurgents against a stand-your-ground nation, young African teenagers and 20-something-year-olds, enactors of what is arguably the nation's most crucial coming-of-age stories, disruptors of a nation that would not, could not fathom what was to come, exploded as a red sky, some said, into national constitutional consciousness, the central character in the 1857 Supreme Court drama, Constitutional People versus Constitutional Property, summarized by Chief Justice Roger B. Taney's footnotes. On June 16, 1858, a cannot stand. He confronted the nation with this hypothetical. If we could first know where we are and whither we are tending, we could then better judge what to do and how to do it. His conundrum, of course, was and is the two-letter word, we. The preamble establishes a class, the we the people class. When Lincoln gave his House Divided speech, the 1787 class of constitutional people, white men property owners, who ran a constitutional experiment for three quarters of a century, 1787 to 1860, were about to slaughter one another over their constitutional property. When black African Negro Red Scott decided to transfer his constitutional status from property to person, Supreme Court Chief Justice Payne articulated for the nation its central, unresolved, we conundrum. The question is simply this. Can a Negro whose ancestors were imported into this country and sold as slaves become a member of the political community formed and brought into existence by the Constitution of the United States, and as such become entitled to all the rights and privileges and immunities guaranteed to its citizens? They had for more than a century before been regarded as beings of an inferior order and altogether unfit to associate with the white race, either in social or political relations, and so far inferior that they had no rights which the white man is bound to respect, and that the Negro might justly and lawfully be reduced to slavery for his benefit. The Constitution declares that it is formed by the people of the United States, and its great object is to declare to be secure to the blessings of liberty to themselves and their posterity. It speaks in general terms of the people of the United States and the citizens of the several states. It does not define what descriptions of persons are intended to be included under these terms, or who shall be regarded as a citizen and one of the people. It uses them as terms so well understood that no further description or definition was necessary. But there are two clauses in the Constitution which point directly and specifically to the Negro race as a separate class of persons and show clearly that they were not regarded as a portion of the people or citizens of the government then formed. By the first clause, the right to purchase and hold this property is directly sanctioned and authorized for 20 years until 1808 by the people who framed the Constitution. And by the second, states pledge themselves to maintain and uphold the right of the master to deliver up to him any slave who may have escaped from his service and be found within their respective territories. Constitutional people, white men, property owners, ran a constitutional experiment for three quarters of a century. That constitutional people class graduated, but only after the slaughter, 600,000 and counting. The first constitutional era in which able-bodied black men did not suffer jail, you don't park your capital assets, you put them to work, was over. The era in which property rights trumped states' rights merged to an end. But Lincoln's conundrum refused to expire. Who were the constitutional people? What did it mean to be a citizen of the United States? Exactly what had been said by the slaughter? Who were we if we was the problem still? That, to be sure, is the question Smith and the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party elevated into the National Democratic Party story at its 1964 convention. President John C. questioned America as a denominator when Humphrey, Rao, and Ruskin, seeking to deliver a resolution, tripped up over we. Unable to imagine a we that embraced the black working class, Johnson's team never saw the opportunity to take Lincoln's conundrum to America and ask it to reconstitute its we the people class. Johnson, Humphrey, Mondale, Ruther, Rao, Ruskin, and King won a battle, but lost the war of Lincoln's we conundrum. If we could first know where we are and whither we are tending, but then better judge what to do and how to do it. Who are we and what can we possibly become if we is the problem still? Steve Stoops at the Southern Educational Fund issued a report last winter on education and poverty. One graph in particular illustrates Lincoln's conundrum. It's a graph that juxtaposes the top versus the bottom quartile of the nation's economic distribution and answers the question, what percent of those quartiles received a good aid over the 40-year span, 1970 to 2010? In 1970, roughly 40% of the top quartile received a good aid, and 40 years later, the percent had doubled. Roughly 80% did so. In 1970, just 7% of the bottom quartile received a BA, and 4 years later, those in the bottom had lurched backward relative to the top, only 9% got a BA. World War II and Circular 3591 announced to anyone astute enough to see it the crumbling of the nation's second constitutional era. An era of states' rights in which young black men, no longer enjoying legal protection as constitutional property, were routinely rounded up by the tens of thousands of vagrancy and put to work by Tennessee coal and iron and U.S. steel in the mines that fueled industrialization of the nation. But Japan bombed Pearl Harbor on December 7th, and 5 days later, on December 12th, President Roosevelt and his Attorney General, Francis Biddle, issued Circular 3591. It instructed every state attorney general to cease prosecuting vagrancy as theft and to prosecute peonage as involuntary servitude and slavery. The president needed young black men to fight his war. As a nation, we have lurched forward and back in constitutional units of time that roughly span three quarters of a century. We are here to celebrate Freedom Summer. We would do well to remember that 50 years ago, a We the People force gathered in Mississippi and launched the nation, for better or worse, into its third constitutional era. It was the right place at the right time. 2 months from now, on December 2nd, Nick Lemon, invited by Vicksburg, will remind the city and the state of a terrorist event reported in the New York Times in the spring of 1874, a newspaper report on political terror, Democrats murdering Republicans, a massacre in Vicksburg over Lincoln's We Conundrum. In his book, Redemption, The Last Battle of the Civil War, Lemon recounts how Mississippi took to the mat the 13, 14, and 15 Civil War amendments when William Alexander Percy, the great-grandfather of Walker Percy, the respectable face of Mississippi Democratic terror, oversaw the articles of impeachment against allocated it to a railroad infrastructure needed to install sharecropping and sharecropper education in the Mississippi Delta. There are different markers of our nation's constitutional heroes, property rights of individuals versus state rights, immigration policy, agrarian versus industrial versus information technologies, and then there is the prison markup for young black men. In our first constitutional era, 1787 to 1863, young black men were not in the prisons. During our second constitutional era, 1890 to 1940, young black men were rounded up for vagrancy and imprisoned to work the mines in a system of involuntary servitude and slavery. In our current constitutional era, young black men without the requisite 21st century educational competencies, surplus slavery, are routinely swept up into the criminal justice routines, along with a growing population of surplus labor that cuts across race, gender, and documentation. 50 is two-thirds of 75. 25 years from now, the cohort that is now between 10 and 40 years old will be between 35 and 65 years old, preparing to run the country. Lincoln's conundrum will not have been resolved, which means that that generation has a job. I recommend that you investigate the preamble as a necessary tool to help you work that job. The preamble does not begin, "We the President," or "We the Congress," or "We the Supreme Court." None of those entities were in existence. Neither does it begin, "We the citizens." It could have begun, "We the citizens of the several states." And if it had, we would be a very different country. No, it begins, "We the people." And we shouldn't take lightly the effort required over the past 2 1/4 centuries to expand the reach of "we" in "We the people" to wider and more inclusive classes of adults. Your generation is tasked with expanding that reach to include the nation's youth. In particular, a constitutional right to a quality public school education and an affirmative constitutional right to vote. The point is, there is nothing stopping us from inducting ourselves into the "We the People" class. We can stand up to "Stand Your Ground," "Stop and Frisk," "Deportation of Undocumented People." Our Constitution provides a mechanism for inducting ourselves into the "We the People" class. If you agree, repeat the preamble after me. Let us enact an induction for ourselves. "We the people of the United States."
"We the people of the United States."
"In order to form a more perfect union."
"In order to form a more perfect union."
"Establish justice."
"Establish justice."
"Ensure domestic tranquility."
"Ensure domestic tranquility."
"Provide for the common defense."
"Provide for the common defense."
"Promote the general welfare."
"Promote the general welfare."
"And secure the blessings of liberty."
"And secure the blessings of liberty."
"To ourselves and our posterity."
"To ourselves and our posterity."
"To ordain and establish."
"To ordain and establish."
"This Constitution."
"This Constitution."
"For the United States of America."
"For the United States of America."
Presumption of innocence is not just a legal concept. In common sense terms, it depends on that generosity of spirit which assumes the best, not the worst, in the stranger. question with regard to voting in particular, or?
That was the example that I used, but also broadly how to sustain change over time.
So I have charge of your generation. I think that your generation has this job that is part of the unfinished evolution of our country. We can take satisfaction in the idea that in spite of ourselves, we've expanded the reach of the preamble, but we haven't expanded it to reach into the nation's youth. And so I think that one big job for your generation is to elevate the public school education of the youth of the country to the level of the Constitution. And your first job is to figure out whether you are mature enough to actually organize and enact conversations about that issue where people are safe to say what they feel. So we are not a country that has been able to have such conversations. So that would be a huge step forward if your generation could take upon itself to try to organize, because that has to be the first step. You're not going to sneak up on this. So that's my answer.
Thank you. Dr. Moses, for your charge to our generation. I apologize if my question is excessively philosophical, but I wonder if you...
So you have to talk about it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize if my question is excessively philosophical, but I wonder if you have any words for the pessimistic pragmatist who says that politics prevent idealism from truly motivating change. You look at Washington and one wonders whether ideals for change have a role in envisioning the future, and whether what can be changed is to be constrained by what the system says is possible. I wonder if you have words of hope or a paradigm you would suggest for addressing change given the restraints of the political system as it stands.
Okay, so I know it sounds really, really, really simplistic, but I'm serious about our preamble. And what we need to do is not think about, yes, there's what it says, but there's also what it does. Now you can think, oh, that's what it did, right? But that's your thought. There's nothing stopping you from thinking what it does, right? And that the preamble actually does bring into being the class of people who are the constitutional people. So there is nothing stopping us from enacting the preamble and declaring ourselves, documented and undocumented, as a class of constitutional people in this country. We don't require the Supreme Court to do that. We can do that for ourselves. The only thing stopping us from doing that is ourselves. And so we have got to find some common center, right, from which we can enact ourselves. Right? And so I'm serious in suggesting that that's